to come here tonight and to listen to you. You are the keynote speaker. The floor is yours. Sean, carry on.
Thank you very much. I'll try and hold this in a sensible place because that seems to be how you control the volume. We have met before. I met you at the last climate march where you had an enormous... I just came up to you and went, hello, Bruce fan. You had a big banner that said, climate change causes war, which is really great.
When you come to a certain age, you can't remember last week, so I'm sorry about that.
That's okay, you meet a lot of fans, I'm sure. So thank you very much for inviting me here today. I'm just getting into the swing of the mayoral campaign, and please excuse the fact that I will be looking at my notes quite a lot. I'm building up towards being able to do a stump speech completely from memory. But I'm not quite there yet, and there's an awful lot to this, and I want to say quite a few things about climate change, so bear with me. There's two main topics I want to talk about. The first is about how in London we should be the most inspiring example of a city taking action on climate change across the whole world, and we are not. The second thing I want to talk about is airports, something that my fellow mayoral candidates are getting themselves in a right muddle over, frankly, and on which we and I am very, very clear. So those are my two topics. First of all, on London, I mean, 2 weeks ago, I went to the launch of something called 100% London, and it's a brilliant campaign run by, it's an independent campaign, but run by people who come out of all the best big NGOs, and it's about getting our capital running entirely on renewable energy by 2050 at the latest. And it's a really vital campaign. I mean, especially in a city as large as London, worldwide cities consume 75% of our energy. We're responsible for 4/5 of greenhouse gases. So every single city, not just ones that can do it easily, but ones as big and complex as London, absolutely have to be leading the way. And we do need to be shifting to 100% renewable energy. We can't just pop out because we're London. I've been passionate about this and talking about this for a very long time. I remember in 2005, I was a small local campaigner in Camden, and Greenpeace provided an enormous amount of brilliant material about decentralised energy, which then we took, me and my fellow Green sort of campaigners in Camden, not just Green Party members, we took it to the council, we presented it to them, we got them really excited about it, and we got decentralised energy put into a number of big developments, including the big one at King's Cross. The material from Greenpeace was that convincing and that good. Then in 2007, I'd been a 4x4 campaigner and persuaded Henley to do some good things. And I was principal speaker of the Green Party. So actually, when Ken Livingstone put together the first climate action plan for London that year, he asked me to write a foreword and help him launch it. This was in the period when the Greens had balance of power over them as well. So I think it was as a representative of that concept as well. So this is the foreword that I wrote for the first London climate action plan. In it, I said, there's some good stuff in here. It had a reasonable plan to cut our emissions by quite a lot. And I said that we must work hard to make sure the ideas in this document are implemented, not left on the shelf next to the fine words and empty promises of the past. Now, I guarantee you Caroline Lucas, in her message later, will say something about fine words and empty promises, because that's what we get on climate change. It was good to see Ken Livingstone taking it very, very seriously, though, and he had some good people around him. And London did make some progress on this initially. We reduced our emissions. We helped found the C40 network of cities, which you'll still see at the COP21 talks, having quite an influence. Mayors from around the world who've made cities greener. We helped found that. Which is really, really good. I'm also impressed in London by the growth recently of community energy. At the 100% London event, they got people standing up all around the audience from community energy projects right around London. And they were telling their own stories of how they put together plans, they convinced their councils, they convinced their churches to put solar panels on top. That kind of energy from the grassroots, I think, is as exciting as Greenpeace's decentralised energy CG-ROMs back in 2005. But since we've had Boris Johnson in charge particularly, we've seen some real backsliding. London is way behind the rest of the country on solar panels, and that shouldn't be happening. I said recently how embarrassing it is when you get on the train north out of London and you look out of the train window and all the villages you're going past, they look like Germany. They've got solar panels on. Elsewhere in the country, people are catching up to this. And we are absolutely way behind. our Victorian and Edwardian terraces in which many, many of us live, they are still overwhelmingly not insulated, which is something I complained about back in 2008 when I was running for mayor. Virtually nothing has been done. The congestion charge area has got smaller under Boris Johnson. He's revived zombie road building ideas such as the Silver Tower Tunnel and also two or three more road bridges and tunnels to the east. This is a crazy thing to do. Building new roads always generates more traffic. And electric car charging points, which you think would be the one thing the Tories could get right, it's actually gone backwards under Boris Johnson. We've got an electric car charging network that's two-thirds out of action halfway most of the places in London, and that's just not good enough. Air pollution as well. Levels of air pollution barely changed in a decade, and Boris Johnson has done nothing about it apart from trying to glue the stuff to the roads. So it's clear to me, London had some leadership on climate change, but it's lost leadership on climate change. And I'm a very proud Londoner. I think our city should be leading the way. And it is very upsetting to me that we've been overtaken by cities like Paris, whose solar and green roofs policy is truly groundbreaking. And New York, whose public spaces programme is genuinely reclaiming that city from cars. I'm not usually into the whole international competitiveness thing when it comes to being a mayoral candidate, but on this I do think we should be leading the way and that we shouldn't be left behind by other cities, especially not Paris and New York. We're gearing up for this election now, and it is quite exciting that this time we might have the greenest election ever. I know that in previous years we've been quite shy about talking about climate change, but it is really, really striking home now. We've seen what's happening in Cumbria this week. In the past few weeks, Charlotte Church and Prince Charles have both got into terrible trouble by talking about how the conflict in Syria is to do with climate change. It is one of the root causes of conflicts in that region. And it's been made to be bad taste to say this, but actually, I think it is absolutely true. There is, at heart, a good point they're both making, even if they're not making it in the most sensitive way possible. But climate change is going to lead to further wars and further conflicts. And there's a serious point here as well. We do need to be thinking about humanitarian responses and policies that respect human rights to deal with the migration that we're going to see. If we think there's a lot of people trying to get into Europe now because of conflicts driven by climate change, we should wait until all the underlying areas of Europe are inundated as well. We should watch out for the whole population of the Netherlands needing to move to other places at some point if we don't deal with this problem. So this election, could it be the greenest election ever? Well, the people behind 100% London did some polling. They found that, 71% of people want whoever is mayor next time to take bold steps to tackle air pollution and climate change. And that's a really high number. People said, about two-thirds of people said, action on climate change and air pollution and other environmental issues will determine how they vote in this election. And I do hope it means that policies we can put forward, like insulating our homes, establishing an Energy for London agency, like Transport for London, getting gas guzzlers off our streets, sorting out closed-loop manufacturing, making sure our waste becomes something we use, not something we bury or burn. All of those things could be policies that we can persuade the other parties to agree on. But we've seen some pretty weird comments out of them in recent weeks, and some what seems to be backsliding. From Zach Goldsmith, we've seen some frankly bizarre comments about bus lanes and cyclists, and Sadiq Khan has challenged Zach Goldsmith to back Gatwick, which I think is completely wrong. Especially when he does it on the same day as he goes out and boasts that he's going to be the greenest mayor ever. So I really hope we can build up our vote in this election. We can pose a very strong green challenge and give them a really hard push. What we need to see in this election is a race to the top on environmental issues, not a backwards slide to the bottom. So that's my view on the election. I wanted to say something about Heathrow because I think it's really, really important that it isn't just about Heathrow, that we also talk about Gatwick, that we also talk about aviation as a whole. I stood in 2008 for mayor, I may have mentioned that already, and at the time I stood in an advert that Greenpeace produced with Brian Paddock, Ken Livingstone and Boris Johnson, and it said all the candidates for mayor are against Heathrow expansion, and that was really, really good. It was great to be in a cross-party agreement like that. And recently I went to the Heathrow rally in Parliament Square, where again, all the candidates for mayor, and even the UKIP candidate, came along and said, yes, we're against Heathrow expansion. So London seems pretty united on that question. But I think the Davis Commission and the other candidates are not being clear that we don't need any airport expansion at all. What we've seen from the people wanting to expand Heathrow and wanting to expand Gatwick is an enormous amount of advertising saying essentially that London needs new airport capacity, but we don't. Even if we expanded Gatwick instead of Heathrow, it would save West London from air pollution, enormous amounts of traffic, but we'd be putting the same problems onto Gatwick. And I don't want to be the Mayor of London who says Gatwick should suffer and not Heathrow. I want to be the Mayor of London who stands up to all the propaganda and says no one should suffer at all, who says that the evidence shows business flying has been in decline for 15 years, that 70% of trips on planes are taken by just 15% of people, and that these are very frequent flyers. The vast majority of us fly once a year or not at all, and those who do fly more than three times a year are basically flying back and forth to their second homes in tax havens. And this is a fact. Those of us, if we only took one trip or one trip a year each, we would not need to expand any of our runways at all. I want you all to look up, when we've finished, the website afreeride.org. That set out a really, really simple change to aviation tax, which will basically give everyone a free flight. No aviation tax on the first flight. And then as you take the second flight, the third flight, and the fourth flight, aviation tax goes up and up and up and up. It will, in the majority, save people money and allow people to fly once a year. It will dampen demand amongst the frequent flyers enough so that our current airport capacity stays where it is, and it will keep our climate emissions from air pollution, from aviation at the levels at which the rest of the economy has a chance of using a bit of carbon in the future as well and keeping us below our limits. It's an absolute genius policy. It comes from the people at Plain Stupid and a little bit from my previous job at Campaign for Better Transport, and I wanted you to look it up as well. Excellent, I've got a whole minute left, excellent. So the thing about the 2007 election campaign, 2008 election campaign, is that in 2007, the year before, we had seen an enormous climate camp. We saw direct action on the ground, creating an absolutely united, enormous campaign within London that meant that Boris Johnson and Ken Livingstone and Brian Paddick all had to stand with me on this. This year, I think we should have the same kind of campaign from the grassroots. We should have people standing up against climate change, against airport expansion, against new roads, taking the campaign to the other candidates, making it so that they have to agree with us. If I have anything to do with it, I'll be getting enough votes in so that I can force them to take my policies seriously. But actually, it's the grassroots on the ground who will do this too. So please, please, please get involved in more campaigns on climate change this year. Please keep air pollution, please keep green energy, please keep insulation high on the list of everyone's demands. Bring it up at every hustings you possibly can. Go to every public meeting where you might see one of the other candidates, and they will listen. They like to hear what the public have to say. They listen to public opinion. And I think between us all, we can make this the greenest election ever. And then we can make the next mayor the green mayor, the first green mayor of London. And if we can't do that, then we can make them the greenest mayor from any other party we've ever seen, listening very, very carefully to Green Assembly members on the London Assembly, of which we will gain many, many more if we can get this strategy right. So please, please, do everything you can, and thank you again for having me today.